Good morning, dear colleagues. Today's very interesting theme, first theme of central nervous system. General overview of the brain, rise of cranial nerves, 12 pairs from the brain, the meninges of the brain and the intrameningeal spaces. First question is general overview of the brain. First of all, let's discuss the development of the brain. There are two positions according to the development. One position according to the evolution point of view, that means phylogenesis of the brain. And another position is individual development of the brain, surnamed ontogenesis. Surely, for us as medical specialists, is most interesting thing is individual genesis of the brain. But nevertheless, we should compare it with evolutionary development and try to understand that they are quite similar. So, first slide demonstrates us the first month of intrauterine development of the embryo, and one of these pictures demonstrates stage of 25 days, and the inferior, the low picture demonstrates the stage of 28 days. Can you explain me 28 days, how much of weeks this embryo has? Sure, 4 weeks. 4 weeks. Really, it means 2 weeks of delay of menstrual period in woman. And in this period, we can see such kind of structures on cranial pole of the embryo, which consist of 3 vesicles in upper pictures, or 5 vesicles in the lower pictures. It's very amazing because only 3 days and development so rapid. 3 vesicles and then 5 vesicles. So the growth of the embryo is extremely rapid. And you can see the Latin terms concerning these vesicles, and let us try to draw this picture together schematically. So, stages of 3 and 5 cerebral vesicles. As in evolution, we can begin from the lower part of the picture, because in evolution the development of the brain starts from lower part, and then according to the evolutionary development, appeared the middle part and anterior or superior parts. So let's draw. This first structure is most inferior vesicles, then middle vesicle, and now is the most superior vesicle. Each of it has its own name. So, prosencephalon, mesencephalon, and rhombencephalon. Encephalon in Greek means brain. So, each of these vesicles has its own prefix, prosencephalon, mesencephalon, rhombencephalon. Sure, we numerate these vesicles from above down. It's obviously, but again, I repeat that according to evolutionary development, it was oppositely from down above. So, this stage of three vesicles, in what age of the embryo it took place? At 25 days, less than 1 month of individual development. Then, rhombencephalon divides into two another vesicles, metencephalon and myelencephalon. Mesencephalon, it doesn't change. And prosencephalon also, it divides into two different types of vesicles. One of them diencephalon, and the most superior is telencephalon. Most important stage of development of the brain, both in evolution and in individual development. Because we are thinking using telencephalon. Without telencephalon, not animal, not human individual, they can't to think. So, here we have drawn the scheme of three vesicle stage and five vesicle stage. And we can understand that these stages differs from one another in age only on 3 days. It's very amazing. 25 and 28 days. It's very important situation to understand the responsibility of each of us, extremely the woman, about the developing a new life. Because if three vesicle stage take place on 25 days, it means 10 days of delay of menstrual period. First delay. So any toxical attack on the organism in this period can result not development of these two paired structures of telencephalon and diencephalon. And so it could be serious anomalies of the neural tube, and such kind of problems like anencephaly, situation when newborn child doesn't have a encephalon, the most large, most superior part of the brain. So let's continue with another scheme, very important scheme. Please draw it in detail. I use three vesicles. So this is first stage, 25 days. Stage of three cerebral vesicles. Again, let's write down the name of each vesicle: prosencephalon, mesencephalon, and rhombencephalon. Rhomb as a geometrical figure, because it really similar to the rhomb. And again, mesencephalon rest as single vesicle, and prosencephalon and rhombencephalon, they develops in metencephalon and myelencephalon, and prosencephalon into diencephalon and telencephalon. Be attentive, the telencephalon is paired structures, and all previous vesicles were unpaired. Do you remember that we have one trunk body and two upper extremities, two lower extremities? We have one mouth, one nose, but two eyes, two ears, and our brain have brainstem which develops from four inferior vesicles and two hemispheres of the brain which develops from telencephalon, right part of telencephalon and left part of telencephalon. So telencephalon during development becomes paired structure. And again, in this period, 28 days, this fact of dividing telencephalon on two paired structures, it could be violated, and as a result, serious anomalies of development. And now for us, very important to know if it is cavity vesicle, it means that inside of it there is any cavity, and this cavity is fulfilled not by vacuum but by fluid. So these cavities they persist through our life inside of the brain. So, metencephalon and myelencephalon, they together through our life is has inside of it so named cavity fourth ventricle. So ventricles numerates, so each of the cavity calls as ventricle, and they are numerated. So mesencephalon, inside of it there is no any ventricle, because the space inside of mesencephalon is very narrow. That's why it calls aqueductus cerebri. Like in Rome, in ancient Rome, there were aqueducts. So, aqueductus cerebri or Silvius aqueduct. So, aqueductus cerebri is a cavity of mesencephalon. And then third ventricle. Third ventricle is the cavity of diencephalon. And telencephalon, because it's paired inside of each part of left and right, there are two ventricles. They called lateral ventricles. Lateral ventricles. Ventriculi laterales. And they numerate from left ventricle. So left ventricle of telencephalon called first ventricle, and second called as right lateral ventricle. So we can remember that, like in the army, I don't know if in Indian army, on Brazil army, or in other countries, from what leg the soldiers become the march, but in Russia from left leg. So when commander pronounce command march, so soldiers using left leg becomes this movement. So in our brain, also first ventricle is left ventricle. And now extremely important for us to know each structure which we can demonstrate on the our specimen, structures which belongs to the derivates of five vesicles. So let's begin from below, from down. Medulla oblongata is result of development from myelencephalon, so named medulla oblongata. From metencephalon develops pons and cerebellum. From mesencephalon develops pedunculus cerebri and lamina quadrigemina. From diencephalon develops thalamus, epiphysis, corpus geniculatum, or corpora geniculatum, they are in plural. Hypothalamus, which contents corpora mammillaria, tuber cinereum, infundibulum, chiasman, tractus opticus. Each of these structures, which is which we are writing down in this list, we ought to demonstrate in our specimen. So your task is to find each this detail, not anywhere and anywhen, but exactly in next your class and in our specimens. And lateral ventricles are inside of hemispheria cerebri, so we ought to demonstrate hemispheria cerebri. Corpus callosum connects right and left hemispheria with each other. Fornix, septum pellucidum, and commissura anterior. So all these structures we need to find and to demonstrate in our specimens. So now let us again try to imagine ourselves how our brain was looking at the 8 week, 2 month of individual development. And now how it looks now, this way. It's medial surface of right cerebral hemisphere. So we have cutted the brain into two symmetrical parts, and now we are looking to the right hemisphere from medial surface. So let's try to understand the most important details. Now this number 14, it is the most inferior part of brainstem. This is brainstem and this is hemispheria. So brainstem, we have said, it's impar part of the brain. And hemispheria is paired part. So the most inferior part of brainstem is number 14, medulla oblongata. Medulla oblongata. Or myelencephalon. So it develops from myelencephalon, from fifth cerebral vesicle on the stage of 5 vesicles. Then number 15, what is it? What is it? Number 15. It's pons or metencephalon. This scheme, this picture helps us to find the structures on the specimen. Then number 12. Here it is, number 12. What is it? It's cerebellum, which develops from metencephalon. Cerebellum develops from metencephalon. Then number 17. What is it? Number 17. Here it is, structure number 17. It's surnamed pedunculus cerebri. Paired structure which could be demonstrated on the sagittal section. Pedunculus cerebri, as derivate of mesencephalon. Then, number 11. Number 11 concerns to this structure. What is it? Number 11. It's lamina quadrigemina or tectum mesencephali. What does it mean, lamina quadrigemina? It means that there are two tubercles here. So another translation means four tubercles lamin. Then number 16. Here it is. Number 16. What is it? Surnamed epiphysis, or another name, corpus pineale. Corpus pineale. It develops from diencephalon. Then, number 18 is hypophysis. Here it is, 18. Here it is, hypophysis. It's very interestingly that in specimens, quite difficult to find and to demonstrate hypophysis. Both in natural specimens and also in rubber moulage models. Why? Because this small but extremely important part of the brain locates, you remember, os sphenoidale in cella turcica, and during patholoanatomical section, when pathologists remove brain from the skull, this part of the brain remains inside of the cella turcica and is cut it off here. That's why in the specimen which is without skull, this very important part, hypophysis, is always cut it off. We can't find, can't demonstrate, that's why, hypophysis in the cerebrum. Then, next part. Next part is tuber cinereum, number 19. Tuber cinereum. Here it is, tuber cinereum. 19 is tuber cinereum. If we are looking for tuber cinereum, we ought to use external side of the brain. But from medial side, it's named with another term, infundibulum. Infundibulum. So, number 19 is infundibulum or tuber cinereum. It's also derivates from diencephalon. And now, number 4. What is it? This structure which looks like comma. What is it? It's surnamed corpus callosum. corpus callosum. It belongs to telencephalon. It connects right and left hemispheres with one another. And now, number 21. Here it is, 21. Excuse me, no, 21 is here. Here it is, 21. It's commissura anterior. Commissura anterior. Also, place which connects right and left parts of the brain. And now, number 22. Here it is. Here it is, 22. It's septum pellucidum. Septum pellucidum. Septum pellucidum translates from Latin as transparent. Transparent. Sept. So, it is quite transparent in life, but when the specimen, natural specimen, is conserved in fixational fluid, formaldehyde or another, it becomes not transparent. But this term, septum pellucidum, means transparent sept. Oh, excuse me, it's a mistake here. I'd like to... Oh no, after we shall change it. Septum, it should be written from letter S, not C. Septum from letter S. And now another picture from very good atlas, very famous atlas of anatomy of Frank Netter. I recommend you very good pictures always we can find in this atlas. It's because this author himself was not only anatomist but also the artist. He himself drew it each this picture. So it isn't the photo, but it is really drawn in pictures. And you can try to find each designation and compare it with the designation on the specimen or rubber model of the brain. And now we can say that we know the development of the brain. So this quite complicated organ is result of development from three and then five small vesicles on cranial pole of neural tube, and it's miraculous how from small vesicles can be such complicated organ developed. Now another question. How 12 pairs of cranial nerves arise from the brain? This is a picture which demonstrates us the inferior surface of the brainstem. So you can recognize its medulla oblongata, its pons, its mesencephalon with pedunculus cerebri dextrum, sinistrum, its part of the diencephalon, and this is telencephalon. And extremely important that from the early beginning of development, these small but extremely important nerves also develop together with structures of the brain, and we should know each of them. There are 12 cranial nerves, so they could be divided into three groups. First group is sensory nerves, which consists of first, second, and 8 pairs of nerves. First is ophthalmic nerve, which provides the process of seeing. Second, olfactory nerve, which provides the feeling of smell. Second is ophthalmic nerve, which provides the feeling of seeing. And 8th pair is vestibular acoustic nerve, which provides the hearing and sensation of the position of the body, and extremely important, the position of the head. The next group is motor nerves. They consist of 3 oculomotor nerves, 3rd, 4th, and 6th pairs, and also number 11 and number 12 nerves. And 3rd group includes mixed nerves. It means they have both motor parts and sensory parts. They are 5th, 7th, 9th, and 10th nerves. So we should distinguish each of it and find where is each of the nerves. So let's use another scheme. This first arrow demonstrate us nervus number 1, nervus olfactorius, but frankly speaking, there are many nervi olfactoria. They are quite thin, and it could be found only in the lamina cribrosa of the skull, and prolongation of them are tractus olfactorius. So tractus olfactorius, it isn't nerve, it is prolongation of numbering of olfactory nerves. So tractus olfactorius belongs to the first pair of the cranial nerves. Then this structure is nervus opticus. It's good seeing that nervus opticus was cutted here, and that's why we can see only those portion of it which was cutted. So nervus opticus was here, and here it is also its prolongation, tractus opticus. Then next arrow of red color to demonstrate third pair, nervus oculomotorius, which emerges in the groove of the medial border of the cerebral peduncle. Here it is, cerebral peduncle, in fossa interpeduncularis. This space called as fossa interpeduncularis, and from inside of it we can find two oculomotor nerves. So here it is, nervus oculomotorius. Then number four, nervus trochlearis. How can we find it? It emerges laterally to the cerebral peduncle. Here it is, pedunculus cerebri. Here it is, from right side, pedunculus cerebri. So this is nervus trochlearis, and this is nervus oculomotorius. If you compare nervus trochlearis and oculomotorius is larger, more thick, and nervus trochlearis is more thinner. And oculomotorius arises from medial surface of pedunculus cerebri, and trochlearis from lateral portion of it. Then number five, it's nervus trigeminus, radix motorius, and close to it again number five, nervus trigeminus, radix sensorius. So on the right side we compare that radix motorius is quite thin and radix sensorius is quite thick. So we can propose, and it's really that as motor nerve, function of the nervus trigeminus isn't so serious. It provides the process of mastication only. And the sensorial function of nervus trigeminus is quite more serious. So it provides all sensations from the head. If we see in tactile sensation of the skin, or pain, or temperature sensation, always nervus trigeminus provides these feelings. And now number six, nervus abducens. Number six is nervus abducens. How can we explain its arising? So it arises between the medulla oblongata. Here it is, medulla oblongata. It would be better to write another word, medulla oblongata. Here it is, medulla oblongata, and exactly so named pyramis and the pons. So nervus abducens. Then number seven, nervus facialis. You can see I use the arrow with different colors to understand that it is mixed nerve, Nerve facialis is a mixed nerve. So it has not only sensorial, not only motor fibers, but also so named vegetative fibers or parasympathetic fibers. Then, close to it, we can find number 8, nervus vestibulo cochlearis, nervus vestibulo cochlearis. And again, nervus vestibulo cochlearis, pars cochlearis. So, from right side, it's better seen because nor any designation. So number 7 and number 8 cranial nerves are located close to each other, and this is number 7th, and this is number 8. And now number 9, nervus glossopharyngeus, nervus glossopharyngeus. You can compare that abducens, facialis, vestibulo cochlearis, they arises as a quite thick single structure, but from this ninth pair we can find that a lot of small fibers connects with each other and form this nerve. So nervus glossopharyngeus, nervus glossopharyngeum. So it's innervate glossus, lingua, tongue, and pharynx, glossopharyngeus. It emerges from the sulcus behind the olive. This is olive. So this is sulcus behind the olive, and there we can find the nervus glossopharyngeus. Then number 10, nervus vagus. Vagus in Latin means those who lose himself. It means he went and then lose the way, because this nerve is extremely difficult with extremely complicated with its pathway through the organism. So they use such term, nervus vagus. Maybe you know the term vagants. Vagantes, so they were the singers in Middle Ages who changes the place of their work from day to day. They went from one place to another. So usually they didn't knew the way for the next their trip and so on. So they named vagantes, minstrels. And the same root for nervus vagus. So vagus means those who lost their way. Number 11, nervus accessorius, nervus accessorius, additional nerve in translation. It emerges from sulcus behind the olive also. So we can explain that from sulcus behind the olive, three nerves arises. Ninth, 10th, and 11th. So all of them arises from the sulcus behind the olives. And the last 12 nerves, this is nervus hypoglossus. In parenthesis, we use the explanation how we can find them in the specimen. So hypoglossus emerges between the pyramid and the olive. This is pyramid, pyramis, and this is olive. So in sulcus, between pyramis and olive. So now all 12 nerves, 12 pairs of cranial nerves, which we ought to know and we ought to demonstrate in our specimens. And now a similar picture with colorized different pairs, so we can compare them. Again, tractus olfactorius, that means number one is continuation, prolongation of nervi olfactori. Then number two is nervus opticus. Then number three is nervus oculomotorius. Then number four is nervus trochlearis. Then number five is nervus trigeminus. Then number six is nervus abducens. Then number seven is nervus facialis. Then number eight, nervus vestibulo cochlearis. Number nine, nervus glossopharyngeus. Number 10, nervus vagus. Number 11, nervus accessorius. And number 12, nervus hypoglossus. So these schemes we shall use in our electronic tests, so be ready to recognize them and be ready to demonstrate each of the nerves on the rubber specimen in our classroom laboratory work. And now to more good understand of the detail of the brainstem structure and principles of the arising cranial nerves, let's together draw such kind of picture. What are these? Letter P means pyramis, which belongs to myelencephalon. Pyramis is part of myelencephalon. Then, laterally to it, we can find paired structures designated with letter O. What is it? O. Olive. Oliva, which belongs also to myelencephalon. Then I draw the sulci, which depicted the next part of the brainstem, pons. This is pons. Then two very important structures which depicted PC. What is PC? Personal computer? No, it's pedunculus cerebri. Pedunculus cerebri, which belongs to mesencephalon. Then, these two important structures, which designated as CM. What is CM? Corpora mammillaria, abbreviation of corpora mammillaria, which belongs to diencephalon. And then TC, tuber cinereum, or infundibulum, which also belongs to diencephalon. TC, tuber cinereum, or infundibulum. And then I use these lines to depict the structures which called TO. What is it? TO. This is tractus opticus, which also belongs to diencephalon, and they are prolongation of nervus opticus. And this part of the cutted part is designated as CHO. What is this? CHO is chiasma opticum. It is also prolongation of nervus opticus and belongs to diencephalon. And now we use this designation, which I write down as delta, Greek symbol, delta OL. What is it? Delta O. Delta for, you remember, trigonum, triangle, trigonum olfactorium, which belongs to telencephalon. And from another side, the same structures. So this with red arrow designation is tractus olfactorius. Tractus olfactorius. Very good task to understand each detail of this picture. So, another red arrow, which means substantia perforata anterior. Substantia perforata anterior. And third red arrow, substantia perforata posterior. Substantia perforata posterior. So, we finished this scheme, and the next your task will be to draw the same by the memory. So, let's try to do it. I use the same lines as in previous picture. And those specimen becomes a very simple scheme. And again, this scheme you ought to draw by heart, by the memory. You can compare. It's, are they similar? Yes, they are similar. But this is photo from specimen, and this is the scheme. So your task to draw the scheme by the heart. So let's summarize. The most complicated organ in our organism, brain, it develops from very simple structures on the 25 and 28 days of intrauterine development. And result of this process of development, we ought to know in detail. So we should, from the first hour classroom work, to demonstrate each of the structures of the specimen and to call its Latin term. So I wish you good result in your studying. Thank you. You are free.